two beautiful countries in the world, India and Australia. This is eCritCare Podcast, podcast about evidence-based critical care medicine, helping you to save lives. Hear our thoughts on controversies and critical care. And now, here are your hosts, Dr. Swapnil Pawar from Sydney and Dr. Jose Checo from India.
Welcome to eCritCare Podcast. This is our episode number 85. And today I'm joined by my co-host, Dr. Jose Checo. So welcome, Dr. Checo.
Hi, Swapnil. Thank you. Nice to be here again.
There was a bit of a delay from my side because the ICU was a bit busy. Good to be back again and discussing the interesting controversy today. That is about the glycemic control in intensive care unit. As we all know, acute hyperglycemia can be an adaptive response to stress. So most of the patients who are admitted to critical care usually get higher blood sugar levels. And the occurrence of hyperglycemia, in particular severe hyperglycemia, is associated with increased morbidity and mortality in a variety of group of patients. However, what's the ideal blood sugar target in intensive care patients still remains the debatable question. Now, some of the barriers to widespread adoption of tight glucose control include the increased risk of severe hyperglycemia, concerns about previously conducted trials in the way in which they were conducted, and also difficult to achieving normal glycemia in critically ill patients. And when we aim for intensely controlled kind of glucose targets, often we need intense or close monitoring, which can be intensive in some of the settings. So what we know so far in this topic is quite interesting. The whole debate started back in 2000 when Vandenberg published some of the single center studies comparing the liberal strategy versus intensive control strategy. And in that study, it was shown that intensive control strategy to maintain the blood sugar level between 80 to 110 milligram per DL may be beneficial. And then after that, suddenly the practices across the ICU were changed to follow this intense controlled blood sugar levels. And this dogma was challenged by NICE Sugar study, which was the largest randomized controlled trial on this topic, which was the parallel group randomized controlled trial involving adult medical and surgical patients admitted to ICU of 42 hospitals. And this trial included almost 6,104 patients, and it showed that 27.5% patients in the intensive control group died compared to 24.9% in the conventional control group, where the sugars were maintained in the range of less than 180 gram per DL, which is equal to 6 to 10 millimole per liter. So after the NICE sugar trial, practices were changed back again, where people thought it may be beneficial to not to go with an intensive control strategy and keep the sugars levels less than 180 milligram per DL or less than 10 millimole per liter in patients who are admitted to ICU. And that has been the kind of standard practice across the Australia and New Zealand intensive care units. Having said that, the recent trial, which is published in Intensive Care Medicine, which is called as controlling study, has actually asked the very interesting question that should we go with this dogmatic practice of aiming for target of less than 180 milligram per DL in all patients who are admitted to ICU? And is there a way or is there a possibility where we can individualize the glycemic targets in patients with ICU? And the hypothesis here was that the optimal glycemic target for critically ill patients could be individualized by targeting the usual glycemia, that is the glycemia prior to critical illness and ICU admission. And the analogy to that is what we normally do in intensive care unit with regards to the blood pressure management. So somebody who is admitted to ICU with a previous or baseline systolic of 90 millimeters of mercury, we don't aim for a very higher blood pressure in those patients. So we aim to target the blood pressure around 90. So I guess that was the concept was used in this trial, where if you know the baseline glycemic target for the patient, then you try to control the blood sugar in ICU closer to those targets. So this study was conducted in France. So this study has got interesting methodology, design, and obviously the results are also quite interesting. So we thought it's quite timely to discuss this controversy. So Dr. Checco, can you please walk us through the methods and results of this trial, please?
Yes, Swapnil. The controlling study, as they call it, is a multicentric, double-blind, randomized controlled trial conducted in 12 centers in France. The study included patients in medical, surgical, and mixed ICUs and was conducted over a 10-month period between May of 2015 and July of 2016. In fact, it was more than a year. They sought to compare a target of 180 milligrams per cent versus blood sugar levels targeted to what they defined as usual glycemia of these patients. So the study population included critically ill adult patients. They excluded patients with severe hypoglycemia, patients who were designed to have limitation of therapy, pregnant patients, and they also excluded diabetic patients who underwent transfusion of more than 3 red blood cell units over the past 3 months, as this may affect the HbA1c levels, which they went by to calculate baseline glucose levels. So how did they plan the glucose control? They came up with the term usual glycemia, which was calculated from the A1C level using a simple formula, 28.7 times A1C minus 46.7 would give the usual glycemia. Reasonably simple equation to follow. For instance, in a patient with A1C level of 8, the usual glycemia would be 183 milligrams per deciliter. So there were two groups, obviously. One, individualized glucose control. In this group of patients, they would target blood sugar levels based on the A1C and based on what their usual glycemia levels are. And the target in the individualized glucose control group was set to the usual glycemia level as calculated, as I mentioned previously, plus 15 milligrams per deciliter or less. A minimum glucose level of 111 milligrams per deciliter was the lowest level that you would target, 111 milligrams per cent, corresponding to an A1C level of 4.96%. And the maximum target was 217, corresponding to an A1C of 8.67%. So that was the individualized control group. What did they do in the conventional control group? They targeted 180 milligrams per deciliter, which, as we discussed, is the usual kind of ballpark number that we follow these days in terms of control of blood sugar in our ICUs. So common management to both groups involved beginning an infusion of insulin when the blood glucose levels touched 180 milligrams per cent, and the insulin infusion was titrated to target levels, as I mentioned. The insulin dose was titrated using an app-based dynamic sliding scale protocol, which the nurses used to adjust the dose of insulin infusion. The rate of infusion was unchanged if the blood sugar level was between the target level and not lower than 29 milligrams per deciliter below the target level. The dose was reduced if the blood sugar level was between 63 milligrams per deciliter and lower than 29 milligrams per deciliter below the target level. The infusion was ceased if the blood sugar level was less than 63, and they administered 30% glucose to bring up the blood sugar levels in that case. The targets were maintained until discharge from ICU. The intervention could be altered if circumstances demanded based on clinician judgment. Nurses were all trained in the use of the CPG app, which they used to titrate the dose of insulin. All of the care was left to the best judgment of the physician involved. So how did they calculate the sample size? They calculated 2,100 patients per group for 90% power to detect a 4% decrease in absolute 90-day mortality, assuming a baseline mortality of 22% in the conventional control group for a 5% level of significance. So the trial was actually stopped after the first interim analysis by the Data and Safety Monitoring Board after analysis of the first 1,860 randomized patients. A low likelihood of benefit and possible evidence of harm related to hypoglycemia was noted at this stage, which resulted in the study being called off at that stage. At the time of stopping, they had enrolled 2,075 patients out of the planned 4,200. So they screened 4,636 patients, 1,024 were assigned to undergo individualized glucose control, 1,051 for conventional control. And in the final analysis, after exclusions and other dropouts, 942 were included in the modified intention to treat analysis in the intensive control group, while 975 were included in the modified intention to treat analysis in the conventional control group. So what were their findings? They found that the percentage of time spent with glycemia between 72 and the target glucose levels was 72% in the intensive control group, while it was 94%, much higher, in the conventional control group. So that was significantly higher. The target levels were much more frequently achieved in the conventional control group compared to the intensive control group. The median time-weighted average glycemia was significantly different between the two groups. For a A1C level of 78, the target, which is the median time-weighted average glycemia, was similar between groups. While outside this range, outside a range of 78 of A1C, there were 93% of patients who fell outside this range. When the AIC level was less than 7%, the time-weighted average glycemia was lower with the individualized control regimen. While when the A1C levels were higher than 8%, the median time-weighted average glycemia was higher in the intensive control group. So for higher HbA1c levels, the time-weighted average, median time-weighted average glycemia was higher with the intensive control group. This was obviously based on their prior A1c levels. So higher the A1c levels, the higher would be the target they would aim for using their regime. The primary outcome that they looked at was the all-cause mortality at 90 days. Mortality occurred in 32.8% of patients in the intensive control group and 30.5% in the conventional control group. So this was not statistically significant. Survival at 90 days was not different between the two groups, 67.2% versus 64.2% in the intensive control versus conventional control. The p-value was 0.23, which suggested no difference in survival at 90 days between the two groups. And they performed adjusted analysis based on age, gender, body mass index, the Charlson score, diabetes status, ICU admission type, the SAPS-2 score, the use of invasive ventilation. After adjusting for all these, there was still no difference observed in the primary outcome of 90-day mortality. What were the secondary outcomes that they looked at? They looked at the 28-day mortality, no difference between the two groups, 74.3% versus 78%. ICU length of stay, 4.1 days versus 4.32. That was the median ICU stay. Again, not different between the two groups. They also analyzed the duration of ASA active drug support, duration of antimicrobial treatment, duration of mechanical ventilation, and the duration of renal replacement therapy, which are all similar between the two groups. So these were secondary outcomes, none of which were different. When they looked at the hypoglycemic events, there was no significant difference in the frequency of severe hypoglycemia. Severe hypoglycemia was defined as blood sugar levels of less than 40 milligrams per deciliter. So this was 3.9% for the intensive control group and 2.5% for the conventional control, although the difference was numerically different. Although severe hypoglycemia was numerically higher with intensive control, the difference was not statistically significant. Hypoglycemia below 72 milligrams per cent was significantly more in the intensive control group, 31.2% versus 15.8%, a p-value of 0.0001. So this again was significantly lower blood sugar levels in the intensive control group. They also performed post hoc analysis, and interestingly, they found that the 90-day mortality was significantly higher with intensive control in subgroups of patients with A1C at the lower end of the spectrum, 5 to 6%. Surgical patients, again, 90-day mortality was higher with intensive control. Non-diabetic patients at baseline, again, mortality was higher at 90 days in the intensive control group. So these were all significant findings on post hoc analysis. The probability of 90-day survival was lower in both groups among patients with blood sugar level of less than 72 milligrams per cent, which again corroborates the findings of the nice sugar study and other studies which hypothesize that the possibility of higher mortality with intensive control could be because of the higher incidence of hypoglycemia in the subgroup. And one needs to remember that in this particular study, patients with a low A1C had lower blood glucose levels and higher A1C levels compared to the conventional control group. So to summarize, the study did not show any difference in the 90-day survival between patients who had a blood glucose target, conventional target of 180 versus a target based on the A1C levels. And the secondary outcomes, which included the 28-day mortality, duration of vasoactive drugs, ventilation, and renal replacement therapy, were also not significantly different. But they got a signal on post-hoc analysis that intensive control based on the A1C level may be harmful in patients at the lower end of the A1C spectrum at 5 to 6% in surgical patients and among non-diabetic patients.
Thanks, Dr. Jacko. So I guess it's more than an intensive control. I think it's more of an individualized glycemic control strategy, which probably ends up in being the intensive control strategy anyways, because then you have to be very vigilant about finding out the targets before the admission and then trying to maintain the glycemic levels close to that individualized glycemic target level. So I guess intensive might not be equal to individualized glycemic control strategy, but it becomes the intensive control strategy, especially in the patients who do have low HbA1c levels. So looking back at the baseline data, there are some interesting facts from the table one, where almost 82% of the patients in each group, individualized control strategy versus conventional control strategy, they all are medical patients. So only 19% of the patients or 18% of the patients in each group were actually surgical patients. And again, that's something interesting to me, because most of the time post-op surgical patients are the one where you see often hyperglycemia more common than the medical patients. In terms of the severity, they were quite well-matched patients between two groups, and almost 50% of the patients in each group were mechanically ventilated. That means they selected a sick cohort of patients. And interestingly, only 25% of the patients in each group were diabetic at the baseline. So almost 75% of the patients were non-diabetic in this trial in each group. And that, I guess, gives us a bit of perspective about how the critically ill patients who don't have diabetes end up in getting acute hyperglycemia due to critical illness when they're admitted to intensive care unit. And again, that highlights the problem, because most of the patients who are non-diabetic, they will not have the problems with sugar control beforehand. So their HbA1c levels will be low. And the physiological response is going to be hyperglycemia due to stress. And I guess the whole question here, or whole the paradigm here, is should we alter this physiological response by giving them extra insulin? And clearly the trial did not show any difference. In fact, showed more harm with trying to control the sugar too much in patients with low HbA1c. So I guess that's something very interesting finding from this trial. So there is no difference between individualized glycemic control strategy versus conventional control strategy. Now, trial is interesting and fascinating because this is probably the first study with a large scale where the authors compared the individualized glycemic control strategy to conventional control strategy. So the concept is novel. And as I said before, the analogy is to control the blood pressure. Also, this is the first study on the glycemic control in ICU, which was performed in a double-blinded manner. Again, so that's another interesting strategy, because a lot of the time doing the double-blinded study in this kind of topic is quite challenging. Also, the exclusion criteria were not too many in the study, and that allowed almost participation of 40% of the ICU patients during the study period. So overall generalizability to medical ICU patients is quite high. Having said that, one of the major limitations is the non-inclusion of post-op surgical patients, or the less number of surgical patients in this study. Glycemia control was managed in both patients via web application, which is another innovative approach. Now, that limits the generalizability of the trial to some extent, because most of the other countries might not have the same web application to manage the blood sugar levels. Now, we use in Australia here sliding scale insulin, and every probably ICU will have their kind of individualized sliding scale insulin strategy. But authors in this study use the very innovative web-based application. Now, this advantage with this application is even the bedside RN can use this application and administer the insulin to the patient based on the sugar level. So it's very similar concept to sliding scale, but because of it's a web-based application, can be done anywhere and can be used easily by relatively non-well-trained personnel. And to large extent, this trial has confirmed the findings from the NICE sugar trial. And it's probably gave us a good signal that keeping the blood sugar targets less than 180 milligram per DL is quite safe and doesn't lead to severe hypoglycemia. And we don't need to go too aggressive in terms of achieving the glycemic control based on patients' pre-ICU glycemic levels. So I guess a very important and novel trial, well conducted, and has obviously a good design. There are some problems with internal and external validity of the trial. Having said that, major take-home message from this trial suggests don't alter the physiological response and try to maintain the blood sugar levels less than 180 milligram per DL, which is not only safe, but also less harmful for the patient. So what's your thoughts, Dr. Jacko?
Yes, Swapnil, as you suggested, it's a fairly unique trial in that they used A1C levels to target the glycemic levels and compared it to the more conventional target of 180 milligrams per deciliter. And of course, they had access to this web-based app, which many of us don't have. And that would have made their job a little easier compared to manually titrating or going by sliding scales, which, as you mentioned, also reduces the generalizability of this trial as well. So at the end of the day, we come to the conclusion that the targeting of blood glucose levels based on A1C levels does not improve the 90-day survival. And one of the limitations of this study would be the fact that the trial was stopped after the first interim analysis. And like most studies which are stopped prematurely, it is limited by a smaller sample size than initially targeted and hence may have been underpowered to come to definitive conclusions. Of course, the study was stopped because of the possibility of a harmful signal from low blood sugar levels in the individualized control group. And one of the other limitations would be the fact that even in the individualized control group, there were many patients, or almost all of them, they managed according to the conventional target of 180 milligrams for varying periods prior to randomization, which again may have affected the final outcomes. The other question is, of course, the precision of the glucometer instrument that they use, which is, of course, in widespread practice across ICUs all over the world. And it may or may not be absolutely accurate. And perhaps that's something we need to investigate further in the future. And of course, the authors also suggest in the discussion that now that they have found that targeting blood glucose levels based on the previous A1C levels are unlikely to be beneficial, they would consider further research at levels targeted slightly higher than the usual glycemia that you get from this equation. That is an area for future research. Aim slightly higher and see if that makes a difference, particularly as we see among patients with low A1C, the outcomes were worse in terms of the 90-day mortality, and also they had more hypoglycemic events. So these are things that perhaps need to be investigated in the future. Overall, a fairly new concept of targeting blood glucose levels based on the A1C level and thus going by what we assume to be the baseline blood glucose levels.
Yeah, no, that's correct. And I guess one of the messages that is very clear for me is if somebody who has got a baseline sugar levels of 80 to 100 milligram per DL, and with the critical illness, the sugar levels go up to 140 or 180. As a treating physician, we don't need to be too worried about it because that's the natural response to stress and allow the sugars to be on a slightly higher side. Because the concept of insulin resistance is quite interesting in patients with critical illness. All patients who are admitted to intensive care unit will have the slightly higher insulin resistance at the time of admission. And over the period of time, this insulin resistance gets better and the sugars level will drop. And one of the challenge in intensive care unit is you can't measure that insulin resistance and obviously can't adjust the glycemic control based on the insulin resistance rather than actual sugar levels. Now, the second important point is a bit of gray area or unknown area. So someone comes with HbA1c of 8 or 9 or 10, and as you mentioned, one of if their sugar levels are at baseline are 300 or 400 milligram per DL or 20, then what should we do? And how quickly should we lower the sugar levels in this individual population? And that is something, that analogy that I use with patients with intracranial bleed or subarachnoid hemorrhage who have high blood pressure. We don't want to lower that very quickly in order to avoid ischemic events. And we try to keep the target slightly flexible, trying to achieve the blood pressure less than 160 instead of less than 140 or less than 120. So whether that kind of concept might be valid in this area where somebody comes with higher sugar levels with higher HbA1c, then because the body has adopted to this new BSL targets, should we be going too aggressive to bring the sugar levels less than 180 in a short period of time? And that answer is still unknown. And I guess that's where the potential area of future research is going to be, where the patients are already diabetic, where they already have high HbA1c levels. And in those cohort or those subgroup of patients, whether allowing slightly liberal glycemic control strategy might be useful compared to conventional glycemic control strategy of targeting the sugar of less than 180 milligram per DL or 10 millimole per liter. So that's something I guess we need to look into in our future randomized control trials. But on the merit, this trial has definitely answered a very important question, because some people might say this is a negative trial and really didn't give us answer, but it definitely confirmed that our current practices are good practices and we don't need to change our practices, because going by individualized glycemic control strategy might actually be harmful in patients who have normal HbA1c and acute physiological stress is probably the useful response for patients who are admitted to intensive care unit. So I guess it won't change my practice. What about you, Dr. Chacko?
Yeah, I agree with you, Swapnil. I don't think it's going to change our practice either. We would stick to the target of 180 to 200 milligrams per cent, which we currently follow. But one of the, I was reading a paper by Vandenberghe the other day, and she was suggesting that the whole problem may be because of our inherent inability to control blood sugars tightly and precisely at the same time, given the fact that we do not still have the widespread use of feedback loop technology to control blood sugar at a very precise level. And perhaps once we attain that kind of precision, and if we are able to maintain blood sugars more diligently at the targets that we need to, perhaps we can change our conceptually, if you maintain the blood sugar within a narrow range, it is plausible that it might improve clinical outcomes than if you allow wide variations in the blood glucose levels. And of course, what that range is may vary from subject to subject and from time to time, depending on the level of stress as well. So that's something that perhaps future research should look at.
Yeah, that's correct. And also we don't consider the diurnal variations in the blood sugar levels, and trying to maintain the blood sugar level constant throughout the day again might not be the best idea, because we do get fluctuation in our blood sugar levels as we have different caloric intake. Because most of the patients in intensive care unit get this constant or continuous nasogastric feeds or parenteral nutrition, we kind of give them constant carbohydrate load and trying to maintain the sugars in a constant range for 24 hours. That's pretty counterintuitive to me in terms of what normally happens with our human body. So I guess there are a lot of uncertainties and more questions in this area, which needs to be answered in the future trials. Again, coming back to this trial, the moment the message is loud and clear that we should aim for sugar levels between 108 to 180 milligram per deciliter or less than 10 millimole per liter in patients who are admitted to intensive care unit. So that's the end of our today's podcast. We'll be back in weeks time with another controversy Till then, goodbye and have a nice time.
Thanks, Swapnil. Thanks, everybody, for listening. And thank you. Until next time, goodbye.
Thanks for listening to eCritCare Podcast. If you like what you just heard, we hope you'll pass along our web address, www.critcareedu.com.au, to your friends and colleagues. And please leave us a positive review on iTunes. Be sure to check out our archive section on our website for previous podcasts. Check us out on Facebook at Critical Care Education. Join us next time for another edition of eCritCare Podcast.